After the capture of Montreal in 1760, the British attempted to take control of the areas south of the Great Lakes, and a truce with the Algonquin tribes was struck in Detroit in September of 1761. However, the arbitrariness of the officials, the dishonesty of traders, and attempts of the colonists to oust Native Americans triggered a rebellion led by Ottawa Chief Pontiac. Pontiac's goal was to drive the British beyond the Appalachian Mountains. He prepared the rebellion over the course of many years. Together with his daughter, he canoed from the Canadian border to Tennessee. Sitting in council by evening campfires, he convinced all of the tribes he met along the way of the need to unite in the fight against the British colonists and to mutually oppose them under a unified leadership. Pontiac created a kind of general staff made up of the representatives of all the native tribes of eastern North America. Yet, if an explorer had entered the Native American village and asked to see the celebrated chief, he would have had some trouble finding Pontiac's wigwam. The Ottawa chief did not stand out from his warriors, either in the way he dressed or in his way of life. Thus, his warriors were more than willing to die for him.
Oh, my God. Thank you.
and Velsar families, two powerful German financiers who traded with the East, began to realize that the discovery of America and Vasco da Gama's African sailing expedition had both lessened the importance of old trade routes and ruined their own monopoly. Therefore, Fugar and Velsar did everything in their power to try to join Spain and Portugal in their trade with the New World. The Portuguese refused Fugar's florins, but Velsar had his way in Spain. In return for a huge loan, the Spanish King Charles granted the Velsars a vast colony in South America. The Velsars' privately owned colony included the whole of present-day Venezuela. In the year following this decree, the first German expedition under Ambrose Ehinger anchored in Coro, a city built by the Spanish approximately 150 kilometers east of Lake Maracaibo. This was the only European settlement on the 2,100-kilometer-long coast of Venezuela. However, there were no natives left on the coastal territory. They had been taken by Spanish slave traders. As there was no labor force along the coast, Ehinger had to move deeper into the continent. The first natives he met told him about a land of gold and its fabulous ruler. In 1531, Ehinger, 200 Germans and Spaniards, and several thousand slaves left Coro in search of a new Tenochtitlan. When the expedition entered the territory of present-day Colombia, the locals brought gold to Ehinger and gave it to him for free or in exchange for various trinkets. However, new troubles came along with the gold. The crossing of the Andes proved to be a nightmare for Ehinger. Many slaves and some Europeans died. Nevertheless, the expedition managed to cross the mountains and finally reached the very heart of Colombia, the Magdalena River. Here the indigenous population put up resistance. Ehinger lost several people in the skirmishes, and when he was some 30 kilometers from the frontiers of El Dorado, he halted the advance and dispatched his booty, over a quarter of a ton, to Coro. We'll be right back.